Hi, everybody. We're excited that you've tuned in with us here at New Covenant Christian Center. Our service starts here shortly.
Amen. We're Pastors Tim and Barb Rigdon. We are just excited that you're there watching. You know, it blows our mind that people tune in, but we pray that something is said or done yes. today will touch your heart. We hope you experience the presence of God, the anointing of God that we're experiencing here in the sanctuary, and we pray it flows through the airwaves right now, whether you're watching on your phone, your tablet, or the Roku TV channel, whatever it may be. We just pray that you're touched.
Yes.
So remember, watch as you are.
You won't leave, the same.
remarkable things you've done. Keep your eyes on the mountain, let the past be dead and gone.
Jesus, thank you, Lord. Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. I've got them grinning at me.
Thank you, Lord. Yes. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Open wide.
They're all smiling at me, but I'm going to tell you what. That song just kind of puts the devil on a run.
Yes.
Yep.
Thank you.
That song will expose religious spirits.
Yes.
Do what?
Bless God. Thank you, Jesus.
I just love it, though. If you will get the essence of what this song is speaking about, it's talking about calling in the lost.
Yes.
Calling those that are hurting. Calling a weary sinner. I don't know about y'all, but I've been a weary sinner.
Amen.
I've been wearied down with the cares of the world and what the world tried to offer and what the world tried to put on me. So that's I'm telling you, it's time that we realize that we've got freedom and liberty in the Holy Ghost through the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Praise God. Just step out. Worship Him.
Just ahead, down the path of forgiveness, salvation is waiting there. We know you built a mighty fortress, 10,000 burdens high. Our love is here to lift you up, here to lift you high. If you're lost and wondering, come stumbling in like a prodigal. All things you've done.
Yes, fix your eyes
on the mountain. Let the past be dead and gone. Come on, saints and sinners, say you can't outrun God. Whatever you've done can't overcome
by the power of the blood.
If you're lost and wandering, come stumbling in like a prodigal child. See the walls start crumbling. Thank you.
Jesus. In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. In the middle of the war, you guard my soul. You alone are the anchor when my sails are torn. Your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm. When the solid ground is falling out from underneath my feet, between the black skies and my red eyes, I can barely see. When I realize I've been sold out by my friends and family, hallelujah, I can feel the rain reminding me in the eye of the storm. The future I picture slowly fade away. When the tears of pain and heartache are pouring down my face, hallelujah, I find my peace in Jesus' name. In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. In the middle of the swallowing, I can barely take a breath. When addiction steals my baby girl, there's nothing I can do. Hallelujah.
My only hope is to trust in you.
Trust the Lord.
In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. In the middle of the
their eyes and listen to these words and think about them as
blessing
I read them
Lord.
To you. The Lord is my shepherd.
Blessing
I
Jesus.
Have all that I need. He lets me rest in green meadows. He leads me beside peaceful streams. He renews my strength and he guides me along right paths, bringing honor to his name. Even when I walk through the darkest of valley,
yes,
I will not be afraid, for you are close beside
yes,
me.
Thank you.
says, sorry, only got a few months left. It's like a bitter pill I'm swallowing. I can barely take a breath. When addiction steals my baby girl, there's nothing I can do.
My only hope's to trust in you. In the eye of the storm,
here about three times, I guess.
Bless her, Lord.
And I've been through a lot of storms. I watched my daddy die of cancer when he's 54. I struggled when my daughter was run over by a car.
Bless her, Jesus.
And then I had surgery and there was nobody there but Jesus. And then my daughter was took when she was 17. She was killed in a car wreck. And then I lost my brother die of cancer. And then I had to go through three major, well, I had a stroke first, and I was paralyzed on my left side today. Thank God I'm not.
Yes.
I can still use my hand. And, like I said, my daughter died when she was 17. And,
Praise God.
All this time, I knew that Jesus was with me.
Yes, he is. Thank you, Lord.
And when I had three major surgeries, my stomach surgeries, I didn't know I was going to live or die, so I would ask Jesus, you know, if you would take me, just take me, because I know I'll be with you, but if you want me to stay here, I will stay here because I know I have you here. And he chose to leave me here. I had got down to 102 pounds, and like I said, I didn't know if I was going to live or die, but I put it in God's hands, and he helped me go on with my life, and I've tried to always work for him and do
Bless
what he
Lord.
Wanted me to do. And so the song come up, he does surround me in my storms.
Yes, he does.
And recently, my husband died of cancer. They gave him 2 months, I guess.
Bless your Lord.
Well, they gave him 3 months, but he only lived two. And he just died February 7th, so again.
Bless your Lord.
Jesus is with me.
He yes, he is.
He holds me, and he, in this storm, he guides me.
Yes.
And I know that I go through these things because I know there's other people that are hurting, and like losing a child, losing parents, losing a husband, and I can tell, well, I know how that's like, but we all are on a different path, we all feel our pain different, and so nobody can tell you how you feel. All they can say is that God is with you, and he's going to help you through, and that's what he does me, he helps me through. And this storm that I'm in, and this song, is just how I feel right now.
Bless her, Lord.
So thank you.
That's all right.
Very much.
Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. Bless her, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, Lord.
You hold my every moment. You call my rage it cease. You walk with me through fire.
Yes, you do, Lord.
You heal all my disease. I trust.
my every moment. You calm my raging seas. You are.
Nothing is impossible. Worshiping. There's a song we're about to do that God has been speaking this word through the church. We've not released this word upon the church so much, just in tidbits, a little bit here, a little bit there. Brent, you may have known a few weeks ago, Brother Brent released a word out of Zechariah 8 about a remnant rising up, about God calling back a remnant and rebuilding the wastelands. Rebuilding the city. And when you're talking about it, not just talking about Providence, talking about the church, yes, talking about God's people rebuilding the house. Brother John Baird, he's not able to be here today. He's not feeling well. He got a word out of Jeremiah 33:11. Said, read it and amplify it. We read it and amplified it. It spoke to us. Barb then got on the message and read the whole chapter. And it just began to talk about the remnants and how God was rising up shepherds.
Yes.
Shepherds who would draw in the flock, who would mend, who wouldn't let one go astray, so to speak, that would be there for them and be real. Well, in the midst of that, Brother Larry hadn't necessarily been privy to all the different words that God had been speaking to us, because we was waiting for the appointed time to release some of this upon the church. Because, see, you got to realize that there's a remnant. A remnant means that there's something left. A remnant ain't a whole piece. It's part of a piece. And I believe that each and every person here under the sound of my voice, and even those that are watching via the internet, you have a part to the puzzle. One of us has a piece of this puzzle that's putting together. And God is once again calling the pieces to come back together. Amen. He's bringing the remnant home because he's about to unleash glory like we've never seen on the earth before.
Yes.
In the midst of this, Brother Larry, he leads intercessory prayer on every other Saturday night at 6 o'clock. And God gave him a vision about these things. But all of a sudden, it came clear to me when Brother Larry spoke this downstairs, what this remnant is becoming. Come on. Because I hadn't got that far to it. But how many knows the Word of God says we know in part and we prophesy in part? Everybody has this part to play. He said, when you come together, let one have a word. Yeah. Let one have a song. Yeah. Let one have a hymn. Yeah. Let's come together. So I want, Brother Larry, share the vision that God gave you in prayer.
Keep in mind, I never talked to Pastor Tim about this, and I never talked to you about this. Never heard anything about this. Out at work, they told me that last week that I had to tone it down. They're getting a little tired of me. But anyway, point being, I was sitting out there in the garage, and I was working. Well, I was praying and just worshiping and having a good time. And let me tell you something. God showed me in a vision a heart.
Yeah.
This heart wasn't pretty. You know what I'm talking about, David? This heart wasn't pretty. It had scars on it. It had scars, and it kind of made me sick at my stomach because I didn't quite understand it. And then God spoke something to me. He said, I'm taking the remnants.
Come on.
You hear what I'm saying? I'm taking the remnant. I said, what's a remnant? Because I wasn't quite for sure. I knew it, but I wasn't quite for sure. And then I started studying from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible.
In a world full of sin.
He's taking those remnants. You hear what I'm saying? He's taking these pieces, piece by piece by piece, and he's putting them together.
Listen.
And when he's completed, you hear what I'm saying? Listen. When he's completed, he'll have a coat of many colors.
Yeah.
He'll have a Christian society. He'll have his people that's going to stand up and say, I'm not going to stand. I'm not going to have the enemy come against me. You hear what I'm saying? We have the authority. We have the power to step on that head every time he pokes up. We've had enough. God's had enough. He says, I'm rising. I'm rising those that's willing to take and
blessing
put those
Jesus
remnants together and create a master.
Blessing
He's
Jesus.
Creating a coat of many colors.
Yes, he is.
I'm
Bless God. Bless him, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Why is it important for God to take remnant pieces and put them together?
Yes.
Because there was a coat of many colors. We read about the story of Joseph.
Yes.
And Joseph had a promise. He had a promise of the palace.
Yes, he did. Thank you, Lord.
But he'd been going through the pit. And he'd been going through Potiphar's house, and he'd been going through a prison. He'd went through all these stages, and I believe that's what the church has been going through over the last few years. We've went through the pits of life, the pitfalls. We've been falsely accused in Potiphar's house before. We've been ripped down and cast into prison falsely, and in the prisons of our own minds of thinking we're not worthy of doing anything because of past failures. But I'm here to tell you today that God is bringing together a coat of many colors, because that coat is a covering, saith the Lord, a covering for the body of Christ to rise up and to enter into the presence of the King in the palace once again. Because, see, you can't go into that King, hallelujah, without that spiritual covering.
That's right.
And God's saying today, I'm going to cover you with a spiritual coat, hallelujah,
yes,
a coat
God.
Of many colors.
Glory.
I thank God for that, because that means we've all got a different background. We've all got it. We've been brought up different. We've all come through different things. We've all faced different situations. And guess what? We've all messed up.
Yes.
We've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. There ain't nobody here got it all together. But thank God that God's taken our past failures and our past strongholds that have been upon our life. And he's rising up an army of outcasts, glory to God, that's coming out of a cave like David's 300 men. And they're going to take the kingdom for the glory of God. And once again, the Lord will be glorified in the land. Hallelujah, saith the Lord. Hallelujah.
Praise God.
I don't know about y'all. It's just like your sister was testifying. I'm tired of the pit.
Amen.
I'm tired of Potiphar's house where he is accused falsely. I'm tired of being imprisoned by what religion and man has to say. I'm ready to step over into the place of the promise.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Hallelujah. You've been promised some things. Don't stop now. Glory to God. Because we're going on. Because God's bringing this remnant together for such a time as this.
Yes, glory.
We've got this new song.
God.
Brother Luke sent this to us. We've heard different versions of it. But he sent this particular version that just spoke to our spirits. And I know when you do a new song, it's like everybody's looking at the wall like it's a cow at a new gate. And I know you may not know the song. You may not know the words. But the Lord dealt with Barb and I about this song. That this song will become an anthem of this church. And I know people say, what do you mean? It's because this is the sound. I think for a season of time, we've had an anthem of the Grace Parade. We did it last week.
Yes.
And it's still there. Come, you saints and sinners the same. It says, come as you are, you won't leave the same.
Yes.
But I believe this speaks prophetically of what's transpiring, has been transpiring, and what's about to take place to the next level.
Amen.
This song was called Glorious Ruins.
Yes.
Ruins is nothing more than a remnant. Ruins are nothing more than what the world says, well, that ain't worth nothing. I'm here to tell you, a lot of you, the world's told you ain't nothing. The world has told you you can't be anything. The world's told you that your past failures and the things you've messed up on, they're not going to allow you to accomplish anything. But I'm here to tell you today, God has sent me all the way here 21 years ago from the mountaintops of North Carolina to Providence,
glory,
to Kentucky,
glory,
to
glory.
Proclaim to you,
yes,
for
Lord.
Such a time as this,
yes,
hallelujah, that God has called you to do great exploits for his name's sake. And God has got greatness embedded in you. There's been greatness embedded in you. The gifts of God are within you. And God is stirring up the gifts of God that's within you. And he's bringing you to a place of oneness with him. Amen. We're stepping over into a new relationship. We're stepping into a place where we can feel him. I know people say, well, you're not saved by feelings, Pastor. I know you ain't saved by feelings, but I thank God I serve a God I can feel. And some may say, oh, I just don't get it. Well, you get it down here at the altar as you humble yourself. Because I'm going to tell you, you ain't going to get this as long as pride is in your life.
Yes.
Hello? You're not going to get this as long as you think, well, I ain't going to wear my stuff out. No, you got to humble yourself before the Lord.
Yes.
And I believe that we're realizing that the Bible says you humble yourself before the Lord. Says, and then he will exalt you in due season. But I want you to worship with us this morning, this song. Just listen to the words. You may not know everything.
And this is not about how we sing it either. You know, you all just sing these words, you know, because this is, we feel this song. Just pray for us, but you all just sing this to him.
What's that, Brother Larry's got?
I'm sorry. I cut this off a little bit too quick. But I wanted to say something real quick. Okay, just exactly what Pastor Tim said. Each one of us has gone through trials and tribulations. Each one of us has these scars, you know, and God's bringing us together. And what I saw in that is some of God's people. I saw an oil coming out of their hands.
Bless God.
It's a healing anointing. It's a
yes.
And you know what God told me? He said we're waiting for a great revival. If you recall, we're waiting for a great revival. Well, let me tell you what God told me. God said, we're looking for the big churches. It's not going to happen in the big churches. It's going to happen in these churches like this, that these people, God's people, are willing to say, I will do what I have to do.
Absolutely.
Brother,
yes,
you've been through a lot. And I don't know, but I know what God told me. God said that those things that you went through was for a purpose. It was for a season. And he brought you here for a purpose and a reason.
Yes,
and don't
Lord.
Give up and don't turn away.
Yes, Lord. Glory to God.
Expect.
Yes.
Expect the unexpected. Expect the unexpected. And when I saw that, I saw oil, healing oil coming out of your hands in a ministry. Expect the unexpected. That's what's wrong with God's people today, is we don't expect the unexpected. We don't expect God to move in our problems.
Praise God.
Like the song said, all things are possible.
Yes. Yes, you are, Lord. When creation folds, still my soul will soar on your mercy. And I'll walk through the fire with my head lifted high and my spirit revived in your story.
The ruin.
glorious grace. Let the ruins come to life in the beauty of your name. Rising up from the ashes, God, forever you'll reign. And my soul will find refuge in the shadow of your wings. I will love you forever and forever.
Thank you, Jesus. Receive this as a sweet smell and aroma, this offering, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen, amen. You can be seated.
Thank you, Lord God. We thank you, Jesus.
Glory.
Thank you, Jesus. Lord, we thank
you. Hallelujah. Praise God. Ain't God good? Hallelujah. Appreciate Brother Miles. He's seen a need. Some of y'all need to realize that. It's in a lot of things. And sometimes you ain't got to have the pastor to come to you and say, hey, will you do this? Will you volunteer for this? Will you volunteer for that? If you see a need in the church, you need to step up to the plate. Amen. I appreciate that. Appreciate Greg being versatile and swapping over. You can play that. I told him to play drums. Yeah. Kelvin. We're going to get Brother Miles back up here on the offering. Amen. Ain't God good? Hallelujah. At this time, are we going to do the offering? I mean, not the offering, but the announcements. Might get the lights over there if somebody would, please.
In a world full of sin. In a world full of sin, one man will make the ultimate sacrifice. In one heart-stopping moment, 3,000 years of prophecy will be fulfilled. This summer, nothing can prepare you for the greatest story ever told. Witness the resurrection of the... Please silence your cell phones.
New Covenant launched our first simulcast that included Facebook Live, right alongside our live stream to our website, app, Roku TV, and Apple TV. Do your part right now by sharing today's stream from our Facebook page to your friends and family.
Fire School meets on Wednesday nights at 6:30 p.m. downstairs. Fire School is an intense training of the saints of God to equip them for the work of the ministry. This class is taught by Brother Brent Branson. All are invited to attend this free midweek class.
Intercessory prayer started back with Brother Larry Greer. The next time of prayer will take place on Saturday, March 4th at 6 p.m. Hope to see you here at the church. If you cannot attend, pray where you are.
The youth now meet on Wednesday nights at 6:30 p.m. downstairs. Bring your teens to be a part of this youth class. Christian Assembly will be hosting a healing service on Sunday, February 19th at 4 p.m. This event will take place in the auditorium of Browning Springs Middle School in Madisonville, Kentucky. Special guests will be Cletty Keith. Mark your calendars for our next Branded by Fire service that will be held on Sunday, March 5th at 6 p.m. Pastor Brian Gibson from River City Church in Owensboro will be ministering. Stay informed. Receive weekly e-newsletters by email and receive text notifications. Sign up at nccprovidence.com/sign-up or text New Covenant to 84576.
With a thing to get you to silence your cell phone. So, hallelujah. Praise God. Anyway, we started doing the video announcements. The reason we do that is because that eliminates about 15 minutes of the service. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm all about eliminating stuff that the anointing's on. We want to take our time when we're in the place of the anointing. Amen. And what God's doing. Amen. How many's ready to give to the Lord today? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, God is good. I love it, Brother Mike does it. That's the reason today we're going to join in our confessional of the offering. And by the way, we do have, if you didn't bring your checkbook, stuff like that, we do have this new way that we can give. Or if you're watching via the internet, you can sow into it. But I'm going to get Brother Mike to pray over the offering today. He has that enthusiasm and anointing on him stuff. But before we do, let's start today. So the Bible says, for the sake of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek your prosperity. Psalms 122, verse 9. So if you would, join with me. Today as we give our offering, we're believing the Lord for it. Jobs and better jobs. Raises and bonuses.
Raises and bonuses.
Benefits and no overtime.
Unless,
unless you need some overtime. Sometimes you need a little overtime. We get ourselves in a pickle and we need a little overtime. Amen. Hallelujah. Sales and good deals. Overflowing tax returns. That's a new one there.
Claims and settlements.
Interest and income.
Rebates and returns.
Checks in the mail.
Gifts and surprises.
Found money.
Bills paid off.
Bills demolished.
Them debts demolished too.
Sorry about that. This is my year of blessing and overflow.
This is my year of blessing and overflow.
I expect more out of heaven than ever before.
I expect more out of heaven than ever before.
Not because I deserve it.
Not because I deserve it.
Or not because I've been good enough.
Not because I've been good enough.
But because He loves me.
I receive my harvest by faith.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Come down here, brother.
Huh? I said you was ready to do it,
wouldn't
you?
That's right. Hallelujah. Just bless that up.
Before I bless the offering, I want to say something. It's kind of strange because I had some on my heart and you said pray for it, so I guess I need to go ahead and say it.
Yes.
Me and my wife was talking last night. Don't cry either, because I'm go ahead and turn around, yeah. Because if she cry, I'm going to start crying. I ain't going to get it out. We was talking yesterday, well, last night about the youth. We got some. She's already doing it. Let me turn around this way. We got something big that's about to happen with the youth. She asked me to say something. And when you got two together. Yeah. That's the thing right there. I think it's time for me to tell my story. And the youth needs to hear it. Youth need to hear this story. Trying to quit. I'm about to jump out my pants.
Please don't.
Oh. I know a lot of y'all say that I'm quiet. I think it's time for me to quit being quiet. Me and my wife got a story to tell.
Yeah.
We gonna tell it.
Yeah.
God spoke to me, He told me. He said, you're gonna lead a generation. You're gonna bring a generation out of this darkness. And I'm probably like everybody else. I'm thinking, why me, God? Why would you choose me to lead a whole generation? A young generation. But I accept the challenge. Hold on, you got too much on you right now. I don't think I was going to pray, but now I don't even think I'm going to pray. Can you come here for a little bit, Brent? I'm going to hug you first. I brought Brent up here, I think it was about, 2 years ago. I don't know, when you was talking, Pastor Tim, when you said when you got saved, the pastor looked at you and you kind of grabbed the chair and you got them white knuckles. I did Brent like it. Brent looked at me, he was walking around preaching and he kept looking at me. I was trying not to make eye contact with him. And then I made eye contact with him, he said, Michael! I said, oh, he got me. He caught me. But you said something to me. You were talking about the rage that I had in me. And you know, the flesh kind of steps in the way. I'm like, what is Brent talking about? I ain't got no rage on me. I'm thinking about it. And you start thinking about everything you're going through, your life. And I got a whole lot built in here. And little stuff, she'll tell you that little stuff happens and you just blow up off little stuff. But you had me come up here and you asked, told me to ask for forgiveness. Almost lost my daddy without even forgiving him. But you called me to the stage. And I got to let everything out up here. Because
yeah.
You did that. God told you to talk to me. You did that for me. And I appreciate you for it. I love you for it. I'm still ready to run somewhere. This is something new right here. But I love it, though. I love it. I love it. I love everybody in this church. I appreciate everything y'all do. I appreciate the love you and Pastor Barb show. Oh, I think it might be time to let this thing go.
Hey, you go preach still. I don't, you ain't gonna let you. His wife sent over, she goes, I had no idea he was going to, because I just turned around to him just a second ago, and I said, I want you to pray over the offering. He said, all right. And she said, I had no idea he was going to do this. I want to tell you something. Barb and I had an idea he was going to do this. We knew it was going to happen. We just didn't know when. I tell you what, some of you better get ready. Some of you have been sitting back, and you like to see the Holy Ghost and the Spirit of God on somebody else. You're kind of like sitting back and say, well, I'm this quiet one. So how many knows Brother Pooh Bear has been the quiet one on the stool up here? Then he started clapping at the offering as a cheerful giver. Nobody told him to do it. He just started doing it. And then you see what happens. You take those little baby steps. But I'm going to tell you what. Eye hath not seen, ear hath not heard, nor has it entered into the hearts of man what God has prepared for those that love him and are called according to his purposes. Today, brother, you got out of the boat. You've been riding around in the boat. The storms have been raging. The Lord's saying it's time that you step out by faith. Today you stepped out by faith. Hallelujah. So I want you to release a prayer upon this offering. And there's a prophetic unction upon this man of God. There's an anointing upon this man of God. Barb and I seen 2.5 years ago what he just spoke out. We've been waiting. We've been waiting for the appointed time. And how many knows it gets darker before it gets light? And the enemy will try to strike down. You think you're going down. We've seen it with this church. We've seen the church go down to nothing. And then the Spirit of God began to move again. And God calling in people. Because, see, the enemy wants to strike you down and say you're not worthy. Who are you? Want to show you failures. Want to show you where you mess up and stuff like that. But I'm going to tell you what. Your failures. And I'm not talking to Brother Michael here just. I'm talking to all of us. Your failures are not bigger than the call of God upon your life. And it's time you get over yourselves and you start stepping into what God has called you to do, because there's a lost and dying world. There are generations after generations that need you to step up to the plate and be who God's called you to be. For we are entering into a season that no longer are we going to stand on the sidelines. No longer are we going to be held back to this side or that side. But it's time that we step up, because God's got a gifting and he's got a calling. It's not just on the preachers. It's not just on the pastors, the evangelists, the teachers, the prophets, the apostles, all the fivefold. It's upon the body of believers, because he said, these signs shall follow them who believe. Amen. And God's rising up the believers in the world today. Glory to God. I'm feeling that same thing. You hold on to me. I won't run either. But God's rising up believers everywhere. It don't matter what your background is. It don't matter what past failures are, your past successes. God's bringing us to a place of oneness that we can trust the Lord with our gifting, and God can trust us with his gifting. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Wait a second before I turn you late. You want to speak
something on this young man? Yeah, just. You know how Tim's been having different people to bless the offer. And last Sunday, you know, it was meant for Jerry, you know, but God spoke to me right then and there. I said, Michael's the one for next week. I knew that Michael, I know, and I've just been waiting. You know, we were in this place when there was a very few people, and we would pray over every chair, so every chair was anointed. And Michael would say, we don't need to forget to pray over every chair. And I'm like, no, you know, he would always bring it to our attention, and we asked him to lead the prayer one night. And, oh, my God. I'm just like, praise God. You know, I know that he has a calling on his life, and I'm so proud. I'm so proud to get to be a part of it and be able to see it. And I just thank God, because this is just the beginning. You know, he's leading by example, you know. He's stepping up, and there's so many more for you in here. So many more. And I just praise God for every one of you. God.
Hallelujah. Come on, brother.
Can I say something?
Can I say something? Can I say something to you, brother? You're putting on that armor. You remember 2 years ago, you're putting on that armor, but it takes you to step out. And God said, you're stepping out. You're putting on that armor. Oh, if you only saw what I saw, the might that, oh, you're stepping out. Don't back up. He says, go forward. Go forward. Don't back up.
Hallelujah. Jesus. Hallelujah. Y'all remember this all started out. We're just going to take up the offering. Okay? We're just going to pray over an offering. How many knows we can't do things just out of religious rituals? We've got to follow the Spirit of the Lord. What's the Lord want to do? What's God want to do? Amen? Praise God. So I think we've come to... Wow. Now, this is another one. Don't ever say that. Go ahead. It's all...
Well, Brother Larry was talking about the ugly heart, and it was disgusting. God showed me that in that ugly heart, there's something good. And he can take that little bit of good that's left in that ugly heart, and he can use that for his glory. So if you're sitting down here and you feel like you have an ugly heart, and I've felt that myself sometimes, because I get angry at times. I get mad at things that's happening in my life. But if you've got that feeling that you've got an ugly heart, just know that there's one thing that's good there. And it may be a small remnant. It may be a bigger remnant. But it's a remnant that God can use. So don't think that just because you feel like your heart's ugly, that God can't use you. Just let him have that small remnant and use it for his glory.
Amen. Amen. Praise God. How many is ready to give to the Lord now? Hallelujah. Brother, pray over this offering.
Lord, I bless you to accept this offering and bless it. Bless everybody that needs anything, that can't, anything in their life that they're going through. I want you to take it out of their heart right now, God. Anybody that can't give, Lord, I want you to just give them a cheerful heart. Yes. Even though they can't give, they want to be cheerful. Yes. Lord, I love you. It's happening again. Receive this offering, Lord. Amen.
For some word. I love the music. I love singing. I love testimony. But how many knows we need the word of God?
Amen.
Amen. Everything must be based upon the word. We can't go outside the word. That has to be our foundation. And I'm going to tell you what, I say this a lot, but this word's what's going to get you through. Thank God for a song. It may touch your heart, but it's the word of God that brings us through things.
Yes. Yep.
See, some of you, I'll get to the message here in a second, but God's just dealing my heart still about some things. You know, we're doing a joint healing service this afternoon at 4 o'clock over in Madisonville, but with the Christian Assembly. And I feel like that this is a forerunner of what God's going to manifest even this afternoon and later on. People are going to get their lives touched even greater. We're going to see miracles. We're going to see these things that God, I believe we can see them this morning. And, but I've got to tell you a testimony of myself. Last week, you all know, I had underneath my shirt, I had a big brace on, back brace, messed up my back. It said it was a bulging disc, partially herniated, and I'd already been 7 or 8 days with it. And so I finally broke down and said, all right, I'm going to go see my chiropractor. Well, I hadn't seen my chiropractor, found out, since 2012. Yes. Been a while. And he's down in Hopkinsville. A great chiropractor, if you need one, Dr. Eric Putty. He's a good Christian man. I love it. You get in the rooms there, they got scriptures on the walls. It's got God is good, all these things. Got to talking. Well, I went down there. He did an adjustment on me, and he didn't lie to me. He said, tomorrow you ain't going to like me. He said, you're going to be sore, but it helped out. And I believe between the adjustments that he did and God's healing touch that, you know, no brace today. I didn't have one on yesterday. And I thank God for it because they've told me in the past when I got diagnosed with that I was going to have surgery. And I thank God that I don't need surgery, amen, for God's healing. But a unique thing can't happen. I'm waddling out of the doctor's office, you know, getting up front where they tell you how much you owe, and I'm walking up there, and I see my wife there, and she's got her phone out showing an app to a couple that's in the waiting room. And I'm not mean to embarrass them or anything. I just thank God for this. But I started realizing just a few minutes ago that my pain and me going to the doctor wasn't about me getting better. My pain is because we had a divine appointment there, and my beautiful bride was out sharing the love of God, and they were sharing the love of God back, the Garcia family. And I'm so glad y'all came today all the way from Katy's, Kentucky. God bless y'all today. You don't realize sometimes why you're going through something. But see, that's where we got to watch ourselves and guard our hearts, that we don't get into murmuring and complaining when we're going through troubled times, that we still rely upon the Word of God and trust God. Because the pain that you're going through may not be about you. You understand? Because, see, God allows us to go through things sometimes so He can get us somewhere else. You know what I'm saying? I would have never been in Hopkinsville, Kentucky last week on a Monday had it not been for the pain that I was feeling in my back. Now, I don't want to experience that no more. I'm like, God, can you not give me a divine appointment another way? Hallelujah. But that happened to work out that way. Well, the thing about it is you have opportunities all over the place to share. And I love the fact they were sharing. This is where you got the book, too, wasn't it? They were sharing what God had done for them. And their daughters wrote an amazing book that we got one, glory to God. And I'm sure you can see them after service. I'm not trying to promote your book, but it's their daughter who wrote it. But it'll speak to you. And it's just amazing that how God brings people together for a purpose. Because He's got a bigger plan than what we understand sometimes. Amen. We don't understand why we go all the way to Key West, Florida, Brother Adam, just to run into somebody that God's got a destiny and a purpose and a plan for our lives for. We don't understand it. We don't know why that we go around at different places. We don't know why, Brother Clarence, that we get a job working at the community college so we can meet other people that work at that community college so we can find a church that's right here underneath our nose all the time. We don't know why we've gone around and we've accomplished and been to different places and went through different situations, but God has ultimately a plan. Yes. Amen. Yes. Turn around, somebody say, God's got a plan. God's got a plan. Sometimes it don't look like it, but God's got a plan.
That's right.
But the one thing that you always got to remember is, because God's got a plan, then we serve.
Yes.
Are you ready? The God of possibilities. Yes. Amen. Yes. The God of possibilities. Because, see, it's the God of possibilities that make impossibilities possible. Amen? It's when it seems like there is no way, He makes a way. He's not just a God who's up there, doesn't understand what we're going through, who doesn't hear our cries, who won't touch us at our point of need, but He is a mountain-moving God, glory to God. He can part the waters if He has to. He can do whatever it needs to. See, the problem is sometimes when we're facing situations like Moses and the children of Israel, they come up and it looked like they were coming to a dead end. Somebody say dead end. When it looked like they were coming to a dead end of the Red Sea, all they could do was look back and see the warriors and the chariots coming. See, when it looks like you come to a dead end, this is for somebody right now. When it looks like you come to a dead end and ain't no way, and all you can see is the chariots are closing in quick. Glory to God, you've got to remember, you serve a God of possibilities. Hallelujah. You serve a God that says, no, you need to turn back around and look again.
Hallelujah.
You looked at that sea, that Red Sea, and you saw it as an obstacle to keep you from going forward. But God sees it as an obstacle to set you free.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Somebody going to get hold of it. You looked at it as, this is what's going to stop me. This is the thing that's going to stop me and bring me to a place where the enemy's going to catch me and destroy me. But God says, when I get a hold of something and I part the Red Seas and you begin to cross over on some dry ground, glory to God, I will cause it to cave in on your enemies behind you.
Yeah.
So you need to look again at what I've got planned for your life. What you thought was going to stop you is going to set you free, glory to God.
Yeah.
The God of possibilities. See, we need to realize that God's got a, he is a God of possibilities.
Yes.
And see, we find in Scripture, if you would, we'll start out here. Let's look at Mark 9, 14. As we're looking at this Scripture, I want to read you some things before I get into this. Mark, while you're getting there, Mark 9, 14. There is, anybody know who Vince Lombardi is? We just had the Super Bowl, and the Super Bowl trophy is called the Vince Lombardi Trophy. And I coached football for several years, and I played football for I don't know how many years, and I'm a football holic. Yeah, I feel like I need to stand before somebody and say, hi, my name is Tim. I love football. But it's one of those things, I enjoy it. And Vince Lombardi, it's called the Vince Lombardi Trophy. You know, he coached the Green Bay Packers. You know, it's just Lambeau Field. You know, all the well, anyway, it's funny. I'm researching the God of possibilities, and this is what I find. Vince Lombardi, I'm quoting him, says, we would accomplish many more things if we did not think of them as impossible.
That's right.
We'd accomplish a lot more, in other words, if we didn't look at every obstacle as impossible. See, because every time you're faced with obstacles in your life, every time you're faced with a pain, with a situation, with something you don't want to deal with, hello? All of a sudden we want to just throw up our hands and quit on God, quit on the things of God. Well, ain't no reason I even need to go to church. I don't even know why I'm even going anymore. I tell you, I don't see nothing changing. I don't see nothing changing. Let me let you know a secret. If you're coming to church just to get things to change, you're coming for the wrong reason. I come to give my worship, my adoration, love on Jesus because he loved on me first. Amen. That's about us giving to the Lord. But how many knows that the byproduct of that is when we give our worship and our adoration to God and we humble ourselves and we pray before God, then God said, I'm going to meet your needs. I'm going to take care of the situation. See, when we realize with the right attitude, we talked about attitude last week, you know, that an antidote for anxiety is the right attitude. You have the right attitude, it'll take you higher, amen, in God. And when we realize that when we get the right attitude about problems and situations and realize, okay, God, I may not like it. It's okay not to like what you're going through. It is. It's okay not to like a situation. It's okay to not be happy about it at all. But don't let the devil steal your joy in the midst of it, amen. Don't let the devil steal away from it because God's got a purpose. And he's got a plan. And to do that, you got to stop thinking about things and everything's impossible. Yeah. And I hear people say all the time, well, I don't know how in the world this is going to work out. Well, good.
That's right. Come on.
Because it ain't how in the world, it's how in the heavens
is
God going to work things out.
Right.
You know, because I still serve a way-making God. And we still serve a mountain-moving God.
Yeah.
We still serve a God who speaks to nothing, tells nothing to be something. Amen.
Yeah.
We read that in Genesis chapter 1. He said he stepped down the platform of nothing, spoke to nothing, said nothing, light be, and light was. See, when you understand that God can speak to your situation and one word from God can change your life forever. Amen? One word from God, hallelujah, can change your life forever. See, that's why we, you know, I hear people say, well, I've been going to church for years and, you know, I'm been prayed over all these times. I've had more oil rubbed on me than a county pig. But yeah, I'm still the same. I'm still dealing with this situation. I'm still whatever. What if the woman with the issue of blood had quit at 11 years and 11 months? What if she had stopped and said, you know what? I've been to the priest. I've been here and I've been there. I've been to all the doctors, spent all I had, and I'm none better. What if she had stopped? But yet she had it in her heart because she had a word from God in her spirit saying, if I can just get to touch the hem of his garment, I can be healed. See, we can't stop in the midst of our trial. We can't stop in the midst of our problem, our situation. If we do, we're going to miss what God's got for you. Amen. I believe there's people under the sound of my voice that you're about to go around a curve in life and you're about to come around that curve and it's a blind curve. But all of a sudden your eyes is about to open. You're going to be like, that's it. That's it. There's about to be a revealing in people's lives. I believe there's many here that you've been struggling. You've been going through the same old path for a long time. But all of a sudden, because you've not quit and you've persevered and you've had a bulldog tenacity about yourself to say, you know, bless God, I'm not letting go, God, to you. Bless me like Jacob did on Jacob's ladder when the angel of God come down and he said he wrestled with God on that line. I'm not going to let go of you. Bless me. God, I'm not going to quit serving you. Amen. Job said it best. He said, though you slay me, I'm still going to serve you. And the world can't understand that. They can't comprehend that. People going through situations in life, going through sickness and disease, going through death and loss and all these things. And everybody's like, oh, I don't understand this. I don't understand that. Now, what? Hey, I ain't saying I understand any of it. But I do understand who is in control. And I understand that I will not lose my peace. I will not lose my joy. I will not lose my focus because I know who brought me this far. I like that old saying, I'm going to dance with the one that brought me to the dance. Come on. I wouldn't be here today if it had not been for the Lord, Him watching out of me. Hallelujah. So we got to stop looking at everything as an impossibility. G.W. Traveling said it this way, never tell a young person that anything can't be done. God may have been waiting for centuries for someone ignorant enough of the impossible to do the very possible. I'm going to say it again. I will paraphrase if you would. Quit telling young people you can't do it. God spoke to me a long time ago and says, there's a generation rising up. Get ready, Brother Michael Black, Chanda Black. There's a generation rising up that'll raise the dead before somebody tells them they can't do that. There's a generation that'll rise up and say, they'll raise the dead. They'll lay hands on the sick and the sick will recover before some religious mind comes up and say, well, God, don't do that no more. My Bible says God don't change. He said He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. So if God did it back then, He'll do it right now. Did the Bible not say that Jesus said, greater exploits shall you do for my name's sake? You're not doing greater exploits for your own sake. You're not doing it for your church. You're not doing it for your denomination, your belief system, or any of that. You're doing it for His name's sake, for Him to get glory. That's the reason we can't touch it and can't take glory away from God. But I'm here to tell you, there's going to be a generation that's going to rise up and they're going to do mighty exploits. Why? Because they're going to be ignorant to the fact that everybody else says it's impossible.
That's right. That's good.
In other words, their ears are going to be deafened to the doubt that the world has. Lord, deafen us from the sounds and the voices of doubt that want to speak into our lives. So there's many voices speak to your life, even as adults. We have lots of influences and many voices, but you've got to realize something. You've got to run them through the filter of the Word of God. You've got to use this as a filtration system. Say, whatsoever is of God, whatsoever is just, pure, and of good report, that I'll apply to my life. But you've got to also realize that the Bible says in John 10, it still says this, hallelujah. It says, my sheep. Everybody say, my sheep.
My sheep.
You is one. Amen. Yes. If you're born again by the Spirit of God, you're one of His sheep. Hallelujah. He said, my sheep will not listen to a stranger.
That's right.
My sheep know my voice and will not listen to a stranger. They're not talking about, well, I know the voice of Pastor Tim or this preacher or that preacher. No, you know the voice of God. And you say, well, I don't know. I ain't never heard God. You know, people say, well, God's never spoke to me. Well, God ain't never come down to me and said, Tim, thou shalt do it. Because He knows it'd freak me out, number one. And then I just go on to be with Him. But He does speak to me so many times in my spirit. And He speaks to me through the Word. Every time I open up the Word with the right attitude,
come on.
When I say right attitude, how can you open up the Bible with the wrong attitude? You can open it up out of duty rather than a desire.
That's good.
Every time I've opened it up out of duty, well, I'm going to do my daily Bible reading. Yeah. I sometimes, not all the time, but a lot of times, I don't get nothing out of it. But when I open it up, it's, Lord, I want to hear from You today. Yeah. Speaking to my life. Out of desire to grow closer to Him. He has never failed me once to challenge my life, speak to my heart, give me something for someone to encourage someone else, whatever it may be. Because this Word is alive. Yes. See, we need to learn to let this Word become a living Word. See, there's two Greek words for the Bible. One is called logos and one is called, come on, it ain't my name. Rhema. Thank you, brother. My brain went, phew. Logo is where we get the word logos from, or logo. The logos of God is the logo. Like you got McDonald's big arches, you know. You recognize that a long way out. You know, you understand that's McDonald's. It's because that's their logo. You know, your phones have got little apples on them. You know what that stands for. It's the logo. Our church has a logo. Amen. New Covenant Christian Center. You know, when you see that, you're like, hey, that's our church. Yep. See, that's a logo. The logo in the Greek, speaking of the Bible, means the written word of God.
Yes.
The written word of God. See, this is the written word of God. But if it stays the written word of God, it's just a good book. But the word rhema speaks of it becoming alive. It's the living word of God. And that's when you open this book and you read it with the right attitude of desire and wanting to be closer to God, and God begins to bring it out and put it into your heart. That's when it becomes the rhema of God. See, we've stuck for too long with the word of God being a logo and it just being this book, and we looked at book, and I don't know about y'all, but when I was in school, that's the reason I know God's got a sense of humor. I was terrible in English. That was my worst subject. Now math, you can give me math problems, I can do it in my head faster than you can do it on a calculator. It's just like that. It just comes natural to me. But you give me English, as you can tell, I can barely talk, let alone read and write. And and then, like, what does God do? He goes, oh yeah, I'm going to make you a preacher where you got to read all the time, you got to study, and you got to talk in front of people. Yeah, because he's got a sense of humor. But in that, if I just sit and read, you know, back in my day when I first got saved, I looked at that and I said, man, that's a big book. I'm like, God, have you not got no cliff notes? You know, we're always looking for the shortcut. I did that with book reports galore. I did not read Moby Dick. I confess now to my English teacher. I didn't read it. I read the cliff notes. And I still just got a D on it, glory to God. D to some means bad. D to me was dynamite. Glory to God. I just like, I got by, glory to God. I'm going to the next grade, hallelujah. But you see something. We're intimidated by the word of God. And if you're intimidated because you look at it as this big book, when you don't realize it's 66 little books. You know, start out small, you know. Read Titus. It's one page. Serious. You know, I mean, get in the Word of God and let it get into you.
Yes.
Somebody needs to hear that. Get into the Word of God and let it get into you. But don't get into it like, well, the preacher talked about reading the Bible today. I better go read home, read my Bible. And then you start, you know, in Genesis. This is the way I did. I used to get convicted. I go to church. Preacher be talking about, you need to read your Bible. So I'd be in Genesis 1, and I'd start reading it, you know, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and the heavens was, and the earth was without void, was with void and without form. And, you know, I'd start reading all of it, and then I'd go to sleep. Then I tried in verse 2, and I tried to do that. And, you know, I just couldn't get into it. Then I thought, well, you know what? We're supposed to be a New Testament church. I'll go to Matthew. So I start Matthew chapter 1. How many knows what Matthew chapter 1 has in it?
Yeah.
In case you haven't read it lately, it's the begats. You say, what in the world's a begat? That's the lineage of everybody. That's, in other words, that's saying, well, this couple here, they had this youngin' over here, and this youngin' over here, he had two youngins, and you can't pronounce their names. You know, and they had 10 youngins. Hallelujah, they loved each other. And it just goes on and on and on. And it's this one begat, this one begat. And I understand the reason why, you know, because we need to see the lineage of David come into Jesus. I understand the purpose of it now. But I was reading the begats, and I'm like, my God, Lord, what am I supposed to be getting out of this? Yep. And I struggled with reading the Bible. Why? Because the Bible itself became an impossibility for me to go through. You see what I'm going? The Bible itself became impossible for me to open it up. And I got to a place in my walk with God, and I'm being honest with you, I got to a place I thought, why bother? You know, or if I'd be on there now, if I had that problem, I'd be like, I'll just wait till somebody puts a verse on Facebook. There's more people get the word off of Facebook anymore than they do from their Bibles. Hello? It's the truth. Because we're not breaking it down. We're not spending the time, because see, it takes effort. It takes time. You know, you can't necessarily read your Bible on your way to work, driving. So you've done put your prayer time in that time. Hello? Y'all got quiet then. Is this still on? Hello? I ain't knocking anybody that prays while they go to go to work. We need to. But we've took our prayer and took our prayer closets as a place of isolation where nothing else can distract us from God, and we put it out on the open road. And therefore, we're away from God in our prayer lives. We're away from God with our word, and we depend upon, well, that's why we pay a preacher. He comes, supposed to come in and break down the word, and we're getting... Let me let you on a secret. You've heard this probably through the years, but you have a physical body and you have a spiritual body, okay? Your spirit man has to be fed just like your natural man has to be fed. And so if you're going to continue on that process, then just to kind of let you know how your spirit man is doing, don't eat except when you read your Bible. Try it. So you can eat right now. Somebody's brought snacks, I'm sure. You can eat right now, but you can't eat again until you open up your Bible. Is some of you going to be fasting for 7 days and seven nights? Oh, no, I come on Wednesday nights, and Brother Brent breaks down the word, so I'll get a little bit of it then. You see what I'm trying to tell you? We're going without the nourishment of the Word of God, and then what happens? Our lives is all in shambles, and we can't understand why things are going on, why this is happening, why that's happening. And God, oh God, and we're crying out to God and stuff. And say, God, why are you not hearing my prayers? Why are you not answering? God's saying, I'm trying to answer you, but you won't open up your Bible so I can tell you what I'm trying to tell you. I've got an answer for your problems. I've got an answer for your situation. I've got something that's going to encourage you today. I've got something that's going to lift you up today. I've got something that's going to pull you up out of that funk that you're in right now. But you won't open up your Bible and spend some time with me so that I can encourage you and build you up in the Word.
That's good. Come on. That's good.
Come on. Because it's easier to sit back and just complain that God don't hear me.
Come on.
Because then I pass the blame over on God. Well, God, you don't hear my prayers. You don't answer my prayers. Then we get into this jealousy situation. Well, how come you're blessing them and you're blessing this one? How come you healed that one, didn't heal me? Why didn't you do this for that one and do this for that one and you didn't do this for this? It's because maybe they took some time to get along with God. I got to get into Scripture. I'm way ahead of myself right here. Let me read some right quick. Not taken away from it. It says, and when he came to the disciples, he saw a great multitude around them, and the scribes disputing with him. See, Jesus just come walking up, bringing into clarity of where we're at right here. The disciples have been trying to cast out a demon out of this young man to heal him. They couldn't do it. It says, and immediately when they saw him, talking about Jesus, all the people were greatly amazed and running to him and greeted him. And he asked the scribes, what are y'all discussing with them? Then one of the crowd answered and said, Teacher, I brought you my son who has a mute spirit. And wherever it seizes him, it throws him in down, and he foams in the mouth and gnashes his teeth, and he becomes rigid. So I spoke to your disciples. Now, this is very careful. Listen to this. This is a man who's on the outside, not necessarily a believer of the Lord yet. He says he's heard about this Jesus. He's bringing his son because he feels like he might can help him. And he couldn't find Jesus, so who did he find? The ones that said they were with Jesus. He found the ones that said, oh, I'm a Christian.
Come on.
Keep a back note of that. The world is looking to see the true power and anointing of God flow, not just Jesus, but through those who say they're a disciple of Jesus, that they're a Christian, that they're a born-again believers. Because even the word, the world knows the word as good as some of the Christians do. Because Mark chapter 16 says, these signs shall follow them who believe.
Yes.
They shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. They shall cast out demons. You know, they shall tread upon serpents. It tells everything about it. Go back and look at Mark 16. Matter of fact, Barb and I, when we're going on a trip, we stop right there at the end of the driveway. And when we're coming home, we stop before we pull out anywhere. And we start to pray together. You ought to try this. We say, Lord, we ask for angels around about our vehicle, watching over, keeping us from harm. Lord, we ask that this vehicle will operate properly, that these tires will operate properly, and you're going to get us back home. When we're leaving, we actually say, Lord, you're going to watch over our house. You're going to watch over our kids. You're going to watch over our family. You're going to watch over our church people. You're going to watch over our church. And we just begin to pray for everybody before we leave town. But then we're all done with that. We say one thing. Come up here and say it with me. You ready?
Yep.
What do we say?
Signs and wonders.
Come on.
Amen.
Signs and wonders. Come on. What are you meaning? Because the Bible says these signs and wonders shall follow them that believe. I'm a believer. They don't follow me because I'm a preacher. They follow me because I believe the word of God. And I'm telling them signs and wonders, all those miracles and all those blessings. I'm saying, hey, we may be leaving town, but you're going with us. Hallelujah. You don't just hang out in the church. You're going to my house. You're going to my family. You're going to, if I'm going to Lexington to the basketball game, glory to God, signs and wonders are following me to Rupp Arena. Hallelujah. Amen. Y'all can laugh. You can laugh. We pray for many a person on our journeys going to and fro that God give us divine appointments. Hey, signs and wonders went to us to Hopkinsville the other day to meet this lovely couple. Amen. Right. Hallelujah. Signs and wonders. We need to start believing that God wants the word and the will and the power of God to follow you wherever you're at. I guarantee you if I worked in the coal mines, I'd be praying that prayer every time I went down. And signs and wonders, you going down with me because I ain't going down that dark hole without you. See, I have a different mentality because I've only been down to coal mines twice, okay? Once, Claudia Osbrook had me go down, and I went down there and anointed every piece of machinery because some things at a particular, I won't say it so he don't ever come back, but went down there and we prayed over a coal mine. Then Brother Johnny May, about 10 years ago, took me down in Dotiki, and I got to go down there, and we did some praying down there too. And that, I know there's a lot of prayers go on down in the coal mines, but I want to thank all those that serve and do that because I want to tell you what, if it was up to me, we'd be sitting in the dark right now. Okay, I understand it. And there's a fear in me. You know, I'm like, okay, brother. And he said, breathe, brother. Now, we're going in. We're going down this. Now getting that elevator shaft and Lord God. That little light at the top of the tunnel is getting smaller and smaller, and I'm just like, how in the world do y'all do it? So my hats go off to it. But before I go down, I would pray. Signs and wonders, come on. You know, with a lot of jobs, you know. I know when you face different situations, you know, and y'all do it so much you don't even think about it. Brother Cody, when he's working iron worker, and he's up on these skyscrapers, you know, just clipping off and unclip and walk over to the next thing. And I'm just like, no. Signs and wonders follow me every step. Lord, you're ordering my steps. You're kind of, I'd be praying in the Holy Ghost so much that the people would think I was crazy and they need to put me in a loony bin. But I'm here to tell you, we need to believe the word of God and they need to follow us. But he told the disciples, go back one verse right there. He told the disciples right here, they said, we've gone to your disciples. Okay, I brought you my, I was wrong. Go ahead. I've lost my spot here. And whoever it sees it throws a grand national team grid, says, so I spoke to your disciples. There it is. Sorry about that. So I spoke to your disciples that they should cast it out, but it says, but they couldn't do it. The ones that's been around Jesus, hanging out with him, seeing all the miracles, that he's been saying greater signs and wonders will you do, greater works will you do in my name's sake. You know, you couldn't do it. And he said, and he answered and he said to him, he's speaking to these disciples especially, he says, oh, faithless generation. That's the thing we got to realize is, hallelujah. Michael Black, Chandler Black, I keep having it. There has come up a faithless generation. If you don't believe it, watch the news. There's a faithless generation. It's not just that they ain't got faith to believe that God can do a miracle. They don't have faith that there's even a God right now. And we need some people to rise up and raise up a generation. He said, oh, faithless generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I bear with you? Bring him to me. All right? Y'all know where we're going here. Verse 20, he said, then they brought him to him, and when he saw him, immediately the spirit convulsed him. In other words, that demon, that devil, it didn't like what was going on. Oh, wait, this is the real thing here. This ain't a bunch of Christians just playing church.
Come on.
Yeah. Come on.
Yes.
Come on.
Uh-oh.
That's good.
This ain't just a bunch of people going through the motions of it that's looking pretty on Sunday, hallelujah, and lifting their hands and shouting glory and then walking out the door and living like the devil. Hello. This is the real thing coming to town now. This is Jesus. You got to realize God's called you to be the real thing. We need to be like that Coke commercial. You got the right one now, baby. You remember that one? We need to be the right one at the right time at the right appointed place. We need to be what God's called us to be at that appointed time and appointed place. Said, and they brought him to Jesus, and when the spirit convulsed in him when he saw him, and said, and he fell upon the ground, and he wallowed, and he foamed at the mouth. Look at what verse 21 says here. So he asked the Father. Now, this was very interesting to me. I don't know if anybody, this is a side note. This has nothing to do with what I'm preaching about. I just thought this was some kind of interesting that Jesus would do this. You got a young man that's demon-possessed, flopping around on the ground, or some versions say that it was an epileptic seizure. Either way, there's something bad going on. He's flopping around, foaming at the mouth. You know, and Jesus, instead of dealing with it right then, he turns around and says, how long has this been happening? I mean, no sense of urgency at all. I've wondered about that. It's like, God, what did it? He goes, yeah, how long has this been happening? Yeah. So Jesus and the boy's daddy, they started having a little conversation here, talking about the boy. Glory to God. Yeah, he liked football when he's young, you know. And he's flopping around on the ground. Am I the only one that's seen this? And so, is that not odd? But how many knows that that's where God's sense of timing is different from our sense of timing? What we sense as, oh my God, you got to do it now, God. God's like, how long has this been happening? It's not that he's not concerned with your situation. It's not that he's not feeling what you're feeling or understanding there's something bad going on. It's just he's saying, it's not time yet. Let's wait a second here. You let him get it out of his system, so to speak. See, when I was younger, I went, and my wife did this too. It's unique about our backgrounds of growing up. So we both became lifeguards. Okay? Think Brother Wayne's got a hat. Where's your hat at, Brother Wayne? Let me see your hat. He got a Christian lifeguard hat. See there? Said, my lifeguard walks on water. Glory to God. Well, this lifeguard, I couldn't walk on water. But what they trained us when we was going through the training there and stuff is when you see someone drowning, you don't jump in right then. You don't go after them right then. You wait till they went down a few times. So they've wore themselves out. Because they told me if they're bigger than you, they're going to drown you too. They're going to pull you down and the same thing that they're dealing with. It's a word for some of us here. There's people around about you, they're going through some stuff and you really feel urgency. I got to go over here and do this. Sometimes you got to wait a little bit. Some of you got kids that they're doing some stuff that you think you need to just rescue them right now. Be careful you don't enable them. Sometimes you got to go let them go down a little bit. Maybe a second time. Maybe a third time. Who knows? Till they finally wear themselves out and they give up. Because until somebody gives up and says, here it is, I surrender it, you can't help them. This is what's going on here with Jesus. With a lifeguard. When I seen him going down, I had a woman. She was quite a bit larger than I was. At the Canton pool, she had went down once, and she walked in but about 5 or 6 feet of water, but I think she was only about 4.5 foot tall. But she was about that size the other direction, too. And so I was 135 pounds soaking wet. And I seen her, and it was my first one that I had to get. And I'm up, and I'm like, and I'm like, oh, my Lord, she's going to drown me. And everybody around me is hollering, get her, get her. And I'm like, and I'm trying to go back to my training, trying to think, if I get in there right now, she's going to drown me. You know, we ain't in that deep of water. But, you know, it had that slope going up to the shallow end. And I'm sitting there, you know, and every voice around me was hollering, you got to get her, you got to get her. And people even get mad because I hadn't jumped in yet. Because I hadn't reached out to help yet. But those people didn't understand the training that I had. So when she went down for like that third time, I said, well, that's it. I jumped in and I was able to grab her, get her from behind, and I took about three steps and I stood her up and said, you're okay. Three steps. Just three steps from safety.
That's right.
But yet she was drowning.
Wow.
But yet three steps away from safety, I would have drowned too. Had I listened to all the voices that were telling me. And all the people was getting upset at me. But I had to listen to my training, go back to it. The same thing is with the Word of God. That we need to listen to the training that we've received by the Word of God and wait for the appointed time for such a time as this. There's people that's dying and going to hell around about us. Friends and family, and you wonder why you went to them and tried to witness to them, and they rejected the truth, and they rejected your what you're trying to share with them. It's because it wasn't the time yet. Because sometimes you got to wait till they go down a few times. Sometimes you got to wait till they get to what some may say rock bottom. You say, well, that's not very Christian-like. No, that's actually Christ-like is what that is. You wait for the appointed time. Because I'm going to here to tell you, there's a lot more of you going to see a lot more fruit, because a lot of you have been saying in your minds, well, brother, I've talked and talked to them. I'm blue in the face. And I've told them about coming to church. And I've told them about Jesus, this and that. And they don't listen to nothing. They don't listen to this. They don't listen to that. But at the appointed time, they're going to come in. Because when it's the appointed time, God says, now, go get my children. Just like he's going to tell Jesus one day. When that appointed time comes, he's going to say, now's the time. See, last week was not the appointed time for Michael Black to stand up here and testify. It wasn't. I wish it was. I've been waiting on this for, like I said, 2.5 years. That me and Barb's been dealing, the Lord's dealt with us, and we said this. I even told Randy at my camper. That's been 2 years ago we had an elder meeting. I told him, Randy was leading you. I said, you know this is just for a season time, don't you, brother? And he goes, yep. I said, you know why? I said, I know Chan is helping out. But I said, and he's a man. that ain't nothing against Chan. She's got a heart for God. But I said, it needs a man. And some people may think that's whatever. I know a woman can do great jobs, and they've been doing great jobs. But there's some young men that needs to be raised up in this church that they see a man of God be a man of God and speak into their lives. Amen. And I thank God, and I spoke to Randy, Barb and I, we shared our hearts. We said, we thank God and we appreciate you filling that position right now. But I said, there's coming a time, and I called you out. And I said, Michael Black is going to rise up to be a new youth leader in our church. 2 years ago. 2 years ago. When, if I'd have went to you then, you'd have been like, oh, I don't know, brother, I don't know. Because it's not the time. When the time comes, it just happens.
Right.
It ain't like pulling teeth. It don't have to come.
That's right. Come on.
When the time comes, you don't have to force things. When the time comes, you can't hold it back any longer.
That's it. Come on. That's right. That's good.
That's why I want to caution each and every one of you here. You know, as your pastor, I love every one of you. Barb and I, we care for you. And you know, a lot of times you may feel like you have a word for the time or season, or you want to share something, stuff like that. I want to caution you, never get offended if we say, not now.
That's right. Come on.
Because we have to do that sometime. Brother Larry, he said two or three things. But how many times have I told you, not now, Brother Gary?
Right.
He didn't go off and so upset, well, Pastor Tim never lets me say nothing to it.
That's right. Come on. That's right.
Because here's the thing. None of y'all got to stand before God one day of what I allow happen
that's
up here.
Right.
I'm the one that has to stand before the Lord.
Right.
Even my wife, she has a part to play in this, a very much part.
Yes.
Couldn't do it without her. But bless God, when rubber meets the road one day, I got to stand before God what I allow to happen right here.
That's right.
Okay? And I'm more afraid of him being upset with me than I am you being upset at me.
Right.
So sometimes I may say, not now.
So
I told Bridget not now. Guess what? She's still here. I've told different ones.
Yeah.
Because you got to be in the flow of things in the season thing. So here is, you got this father saying, well, he said to him, how long has it been happening to him? And he said, from childhood. Let's get back in this right quick. I got to end this thing. says, and often he's thrown himself both in the fire and in the water to destroy him. But if you can do anything, have compassion on us. See, here's the question that so many people push to God, and we don't realize that this is actually a spirit of doubt. So if you can do anything. If you can do anything. And see, have compassion on us. If you can do anything. I told Brent and I were sharing this week. Brent, you may have to help me. But I spoke this out, brother. I said, the problem we got to get to in church and in ministry is we got to learn to move with compassion instead of pity.
Right.
What a, you remember, I said, we kind of paused and had a Selah moment, and then we said, we need to write that down.
And we didn't.
And we didn't. We need to learn to move with compassion, not pity. Because pity don't set you free. Pity don't set you free. Pity enables. That's it. Pity enables. Compassion sets people free.
Right.
Wow. That's good. Glory to God. I'm glad the Lord brought it back to me. I hope. Yeah, pity. Pity ain't really you helping out somebody. Pity's you making yourself feel good that you did something.
Come on. Good.
Compassion is about moving for another person.
Yes.
Pity is about you feeling good about yourself. Well, I helped them out, boy. They didn't have no gas money, so I gave them some gas money. God bless you. But if you didn't do it out of compassion, you missed the mark. Because see, pity will enable them, but compassion will help them and set them free. Amen. Wow. You never find anywhere in Scripture where Jesus said he moved with pity. It said he moved with compassion. So right here he said, if you can do anything, have compassion on us. And Jesus said to him, if you can believe, everybody say it together, all things are possible to him who believes. All things are possible to who? You believe. If you can just believe. If you can just believe, all things are possible. All things. You know what the interesting thing here he said? All things are possible to you if you believe. He didn't say all things are possible for Jesus, because Jesus knows all things are possible for him. He said all things are possible for you. Now, I missed something when I was going to say it. I ain't going to go back to the Scripture, but when Jesus asked him, how long has this been happening? He said, from a childhood, it's been throwing him in the fire and then throwing him in the water, trying to destroy him. The thing we got to realize is there's an act of the enemy, an assignment of the enemy that's been upon your life from a childhood to destroy you. It's cast you into the fires of this life. It's tried to drown you with the sorrows and the troubles of this world. But glory to God, here comes Jesus, amen? Here comes Jesus, and he said, okay, I can do these things, and you can do these things. He said, if you can believe, all things are possible to him that believes. And look at verse 24. Immediately, the father of the child cried out, because why? He got a word from God. You see this? He got a word from the Lord, because the Lord told him, if you can believe, all things are possible. If you can believe, your son can be set free of this. If you can believe, your son can be healed right now. Immediately the father of the child cried out and said to the tear, with tears, Lord, I believe, but help my unbelief.
Come on.
Now some think that's reciprocals. That's opposites right there. No, that's honesty. That's honesty. There's not a person in here that if I bring anybody up here with whatever need they may have, somebody could be dealing with cancer, and I say, how many believes that God can heal them? Now everybody will go, amen, and lift your hand. But if I bring you up here and you're the one dealing with it, you can't stand there with all sincerity. I don't think. Maybe you can. If you can, you can pray for me. You know, if I'm the one dealing with it and I'm standing here, yeah, I believe that God can, but I'm like this man, Willie.
Come on.
And so I'd have to say, God, I believe you can, but help me with my unbelief. The unbelief is not that God can do something. The unbelief is that God will do something.
That's right. Come on.
Do you see that? There's two things. There's two belief systems that come crashing together right here. And we've got to get to the place in God where we don't just believe that God can, but we believe that God will do it. Amen?
Come on. Good.
Hallelujah. Yes. Immediately the Father said, Lord, help me with my unbelief. And look at verse 25. Hallelujah. When Jesus saw the people came running together, he rebuked the unclean spirit, saying to it, deaf and dumb spirit, I command you, come out of him and enter him no more. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. No more. Ain't going to hang out there no more. Let's go to the next one. When the spirit cried out and convulsed him greatly, it came out of him. And look at this. He became as dead, as one dead. So Benny said, he's dead. Can I put to you, y'all can, some may not agree with this, but I think about this, I'm like, what happened to him? Jesus is praying for him, and all of a sudden he fell down on the ground, and he's lifeless. Not saying, I'm not trying to make a doctrinal statement right here, okay? I'm just getting your theological minds to think about it, but would this be an example of somebody falling out in the Holy Ghost? Would this be an example of someone being slain in the spirit? Would this be an example of someone being overcome by the power of God so much they couldn't move, they just laid there in the presence of God? Yes. I think it is. Yes. Everybody around says, that boy's dead. Well, he was flopping around and foaming at the mouth and stuff, and then all of a sudden, peace is over him. And look, everybody thought, well, he's dead. But Jesus took him by the hand, lifted him up, and he arose. Why? Because he wasn't dead. He was overcome.
That's right. Come on.
There's a difference. He wasn't dead. He was overcome by the presence of God. So Jesus took him by the hand, lifted him up, and he arose. Look at verse 28. And when he had come to the house, his disciples asked him privately, because they didn't want to do it out there before everybody else. They're like, hey, Jesus, why can we not cast it out? What does he say to them? And he said to them, this kind can come out by nothing but prayer and fasting. Prayer and fasting. See, prayer and fasting speaks of two things. It speaks of commitment, and it speaks of time invested. Prayer and fasting. Sometimes we're going through some things. Now, here's the thing you got to realize. You don't pray and you don't fast just to get God to do something. Okay? Prayer and fasting doesn't change God. Fasting changes you. So you line yourself up with the word and the will of God. Amen? So you cleanse yourself of some things so you can hear from the Lord. So it's not about you manipulating God to answer you. It's about God changing things in your life so you can hear him when he does answer you. Amen? But Jesus said this kind comes out by prayer and fasting. Why? Because the disciples at this point in their walk were not willing to invest the time and the commitment to see this to come to pass. I got one more scripture, just one verse I want to read you right quick. Matthew 19, 26. Just to reaffirm this, because the Bible says that we need the sum of the scriptures to equal truth. The sum of the scriptures, not just one, but multiple ones. Right here, Matthew 19, 26 said, but Jesus looked at them and he said to them, with men this is impossible, but with God all things are possible. You need to realize that today. With men, it is impossible. But with God, all things are possible. Because we serve a God of possibilities.
Right.
Want me to define it another way? With doctors, it is impossible. But with God, all things are possible.
Right.
With the banker and the bill collectors, it looks impossible. But with God, all things are possible. All things. I preach today this word, not so much for this moment. We're going to pray for some people and all that. But I believe God's having me to lay a foundation to where you can go into this afternoon, especially those that need healing to your body, that you can receive it, because it looks impossible right now. And you've had doctors told you, you can't do it. There's no cure. There's no this. There's no that. But with God, all things are possible.
Yeah.
And when we check him in and go, we're serving the God of possibilities.
Yes.
He changes the impossible into the possible. So I want you to go in the right attitude. I also want you to go in the right attitude that you're not seeking a man to touch you or heal you.
That's right.
Yeah. Wow. Okay? Because I'm going to tell you what. God uses vessels of honor to flow through. And he called, he said, for men to lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. But them men better realize it ain't them men that's doing the healing, it's God's doing the healing.
That's right.
So I want to let y'all know, last week, you remember my back was so bad, and I asked for people who had something wrong with your back, we want to pray with you. It like to floored me when I seen everybody coming forward. There was, you know, 30, 40 people. I was like, oh my goodness, what? But you know that there's so many people that had different things happen to them. You know, and I hope they don't mind me sharing. If you do, tell me. Next time I tell you something, don't ever say nothing, okay? But it's funny, y'all said, John Dunn told me after service, he said, Pastor, when you touched, I didn't know he injured his back on January the 2nd. Is that right? And he'd not got to do a lot of work. He said, he hadn't been to church, hadn't been able to get here. He's been down with his back. He said, when we were praying for him, I reached around and I touched the exact spot where it hurt. He said, I felt warmth there. I didn't find out till Wednesday night. I'm going to share it. Adam said, Pastor, you come up to pray for me from my back. But says, then you touched me up in here. And you said, God's taking care of that up in there too. And he said, I was like, well, I don't know. I ain't got nothing wrong there. He just kind of went with the flow, I guess. Does it happen twice now? Or once?
No, it's just once.
Okay. I thought you...
I've had two.
Oh, yeah. But he went home Sunday night and passed a kidney stone. They didn't even know he had. But it got revealed. And it, of course, there was the usual pain involved and stuff like that. But it's like, you know, God was taking care of that when I didn't even know there was anything wrong with her. She's not able to be here today. Brother Bobby and Sister Kayla Bates. She was working the kids' church. We're downstairs at spaghetti dinner after it. And she's sitting there, and they said, yeah, I wish Kayla could have got in on the prayer. Her back's met. So we started praying for her. Well, Barb reaches around her and just begins to touch her in one specific place. You know, the Lord's going to, and she said, I felt heat coming. She said, and that was the exact point where I needed healing in my body. You know, I think Brother Larry, not necessarily this Sunday, but the other Sunday, when walked back to there, didn't even know what it was praying for. But he'd got a card dropped on him when he's working on it and crushed him. And he said he couldn't even lift his hands up to praise the Lord, you know, for since the summer, I think. Correct me if I tell you this right. And said, God touched him. And he said, look here, what I can do. He said, my wife had to lift my hands. And God healed. I'm telling you all these things, this. I didn't heal nobody. Barb didn't heal nobody. Neither did you heal anybody. God's the healer. All we do is do the act of obedience of what the Word of God said. The Word of God says, lay hands on the sick or anoint him with oil, and he shall heal him. So in that, I don't want you going this afternoon to the service. If you go to it, don't go looking for a man to heal you. Okay? That's all I'm saying. Look to God. And here's the thing. God can heal you right now sitting there with nobody touching you. God can heal you as you go home today. You can be laying in your bed or sitting in your easy chair or watching TV in the most unspiritual moment in your life. And glory to God, God can still touch you. Okay? So we're not limiting God. But I do believe when there's a corporate anointing, there's a higher level of a possibility.
Yes.
Because we've been praying. And Christian Assembly's been praying. And all these different churches and ministers and Heritage Fellowship out of Florence, Kentucky, all coming together for such a time as this to release it. And also that God has been using mightily Brother Cuddy Heath, the pastor at Heritage Fellowship in Florence, in healing. And he gets a word of knowledge about it, which if you don't know what a word of knowledge is in Scripture, that's when it says that the Lord will reveal to somebody something about somebody that they shouldn't know. You know, and that's one of the ways he operates in, that he'll get a word of knowledge sometimes that there's somebody. And I mean, it's not just, okay, somebody here's got a backache, because we see what happens when that happens. Okay? I'm talking about specifics. And I believe that God can touch you today. So I encourage you to go to that. Let's pray. Father God, I thank you for your word. It doesn't go out void, but it accomplishes what it's sent to do, and it's pleasing and prosperous. Lord, I thank you that you magnify and manifest your word, Lord, in us. I don't want to leave here without this opportunity, with heads bowed and eyes closed, nobody looking around. If you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, or you know Him and you know He's a God of possibilities, but yet you're backslid on Him, or you're drawn away from Him, or you know there's something in your life that needs to change, would you just lift up your hand today and say, pray for me today, Pastor, I need to change. Anybody else? God sees that hand. Hallelujah. Hands going up all over the place. Thank you, God.
Folks, I'm glad you tuned in today. We pray that something was there, something that was sung or whatever.
Before we leave here, so I'm going to encourage you. Here in a moment, we're going to lift, stand to our feet as we do. If you've lifted your hand, or maybe if you didn't, but you want prayer, or you want prayer for something maybe that we've not called out, we just need prayer.
Folks, I'm glad you tuned in today. We pray that something was said, or something that was sung, or whatever it may be, has touched your little heart today. It's tugging at your heart. Now, we don't know where you are right now in your walk with God, or what your experience, what you may be going through right now. But we believe that the power of God that we've sensed in this service today can touch you right now where you're at. So if you would, let us pray with you right now. Father God, we just ask right now by the power of God and the anointing of God that you release that anointing to break every yoke of bondage off of everyone's life that's watching. For everyone who needs a salvation to their hearts, Lord, that they ask you into their hearts today. For everyone who needs a healing touch to their body, Lord, that you touch their body. For everyone that needs healing to their hearts, Father God, for emotions or whatever they're going through, that you touch them right now. Lord, I pray for those marriages that are struggling right now, that you begin to touch them, Father God. For those that are struggling back and forth with their children or their parents, God, we ask that you minister to that. We speak peace to households, Lord. Yes. Lord, I ask you to take care of financial situations, Lord. Lord, you said you'd supply our needs according to your riches and glory. And Lord, we thank you for that, that you're touching people in their financial realm too, yes. Father God. Lord, I don't know what people are going through right now, but Lord, you do. Yes. And Lord, your hand's not too short, nor is your ear deafened to the cries of your people. Yes. So Lord, we ask you right now to minister to those folks by the Spirit of God. We ask for ministering angels to be sent right now. And Lord, we thank you ahead of time for what you're going to do.
Yes, we do.
In Jesus' name. Yes. Remember, if you were touched, especially if you asked Jesus in your heart, or whatever it may be, if God has changed your life or you've been touched by this, get word to us. Send us an email, an inbox, go on Facebook, whatever it may be. But let us know, because we want to continue to pray and we want to give God glory for it. And let everyone in the congregation know, look what the Lord has done. So thank you for watching. God bless you.